Hello and welcome to People Keep Dying, a podcast where I talk about people who die. I'm your host, Angela, and today I have my friend Amy as my guest.
Hello, everyone.
Amy isn't interested in murders or really any of that stuff.
Because I'm boring.
So I thought maybe it'd be interesting to have someone who isn't super into the same things as I am, because she's not going to find any of this super, well, she might find some of this super fascinating.
I like storytelling, but the murder part is a little bit
scary. So I didn't choose a murder just for you.
Yay, thank you.
And I chose a musician. Oh, and
perfect.
He dies in your birth country of Japan.
Oh, yes. I was born in Japan.
Whoop, whoop. So I chose all of this for you.
Thank you.
So I looked up interviews of him to figure out how to say his name, and I'm pretty sure I'm going to still say it wrong, because I'm going to call him by his last name after this initial intro.
Okay.
So his name is Wong Ka Kui, who was born on June 10th, 1962 in British Hong Kong. And I don't know why I wrote this down, but in case you're wondering, this was a period in time when Hong Kong was governed as a colony under British rule, which kind of shows you like how long ago this was. Okay.
Got it.
So during his youth, Wong became fascinated with American and European music. Mm-hmm. And when he was 15, he received a beat up acoustic guitar from his neighbor, which he repaired himself. And from that point on, he taught himself how to play the guitar and started committing himself to learn as much about music as possible. Like every idealistic like teenager, I think.
Nice.
During that time. Yeah. Mm-hmm. While working like different kinds of jobs to meet ends meet. But in 1983, that would change, because at the age of 21, he would meet Yip Sai Wing in a piano company. Their mutual interest in music kind of brought them together, and then they quickly became friends. And then that led to them creating the band Beyond, which you wouldn't have heard about if you are not like
from Japan.
Hong Kong, oh, from or Japan, even. Yeah. They're a really big band if you're well aware of pop culture from that area. But obviously you wouldn't be.
Don't know.
Didn't
I'm
live
sorry.
In Japan for very long.
Nope.
So the lineup comprised of Wong on vocals and rhythm guitar, mm-hmm. and Sai Wing on drums, William Tang on lead guitar, and Lee Win Chu on bass. Okay. And they were quickly recognized as a band to watch out for, as they won Best Band in a competition sponsored by Guitar Magazine that same year. So that same year that they dealt as a band is when like they're already being recognized as like, oh, you guys are different.
Which, yeah, that's pretty good.
Yeah, yeah. Which they were. So in 1984, Wing Chu was replaced on bass by Wong's younger brother, Kai Kyung. And in 1985, Paul Won will become the lead guitarist for the band after the former lead guitarist Chan Siu-she On left to go abroad. And that's just kind of like giving you like really brief whatever history of like the band. Right. And there probably won't be mentioned again in the rest of the story.
Okay.
So anyways, Won had previously designed posters and record covers for the band, which is how he knew them. But Beyond remained an independent band, playing shows at nightclubs and at schools. And their early styles were kind of more like hard rock, new wave, like post-punk, experimental, avant-garde, like kind of, you know, like there it wasn't mainstream.
Right.
So they self-published Goodbye Ideals on cassette. And they did okay, but it wasn't like, you know, like an actual like really big band or anything.
Right.
But they catch the attention of music manager Leslie Chan, who saw Beyond play and was immediately impressed with their style. He became a manager and invited him to sign with Kin's Music, a music label in Hong Kong. While on paper, this sounded like a successful partnership, mainstream listeners in Hong Kong did not really like their musical style. And that's like, this is like the 80s. That's how it was.
That's normal.
Yeah, they weren't used to it and they didn't really like it. And like punk and everything else was kind of big here. And so was rock, but not the same way. And my cat's harassing her.
Yeah, your cat's attacking my clothing, but that's fine.
It's okay. No, he loves you. Their album sales didn't do very well, which led to them making their first official album with the label Arabian Dancing Girl in 1987. Because they had like the original like cassette, but it wasn't a full album. I think it was more like an EP or something.
Right.
Their sound was softened with keyboards, but then it also like changed the way they sounded, and they started receiving heavy criticism in the rock community, who was basically like, you're selling out. What are you doing?
Right.
So other rock bands criticized their choice of commercialization of their original hard rock sound, mm-hmm. like they're selling out.
Right.
So in 1988, Beyond released the pop album Modern Stage, which included some slow-paced love songs and songs with satirical, socially critical lyrics, which even more so. But I mean, how are you supposed to feed yourself and become a big band if you don't, you know, try to, I guess, like accommodate experiment to everyone else?
Yeah.
So Modern Stage also did not do well, which led to their management company to threaten them that they would have no longer have any opportunities to provide for them if they failed again. So that their next album had to do well or they were screwed.
Right.
And obviously, because they are a big band, they do. Mm-hmm. So realizing they would just have to bite the bullet and fully sell out to become a commercial success, mm-hmm. they released Secret Police. And this time it had even more pop songs. Because like pop was, that's the genre that you want to go into.
Pop never dies. Mm-hmm.
Songs such as The Grand Earth and Like You became very popular, which led to Beyond getting increased recognition and more frequent public appearances.
Okay.
These public appearances would be a double-edged sword, as Beyond would go on to record Social Party, a satirical song about Hong Kong's entertainment industry and how it's along with, like it kind of forces musicians to appear in like really stupid game TV shows like you see on YouTube. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So then it has nothing to do with their music. They just have to do it.
Yeah, they have to do it for publicity.
And so it's like, I really want the success, but I also to be like appearing more often on TV to show up in these stupid games.
Cringy.
And So as Beyond started to gain more popularity, they had also become more socially aware, paying more attention to social songs, like social issues and ongoing events in the world.
Okay.
So Wong ended up winning Best Lyrics Award for Glorious Years, which was a tribute to Nelson Mandela. Mm. And in 1991, Beyond visited Kenya and witnessed firsthand like the incredible misery and poverty there. And so when they got back, they wrote several songs addressing the serious problems that they saw in Africa.
Nice, smart.
Which, you know, it's more than you can say about a lot of bands, especially back then. This led the band to create the Beyond Third World Foundation. And I think most of the money came from like their previous records.
Right.
But I'm not, like, I looked it up briefly, but I should probably look it up more to see what they do. But I'm pretty sure they just give back to poverty-stricken communities in Africa. Yeah. So in Hong Kong, they soon realized that their musical artistry would be more restricted, and they looked to Japan for more musical freedom, because Japan for sure has more, which is what's going to lead us to why I chose this story for you. So in January 1992, Beyond signed a worldwide management contract with Japanese record label Amused. And they released the album Continued Revolution that same year. Because in Asia, I had noticed, at least when I listened to a lot of K-pop, that they release an album every year. That's how you stay relevant.
It's very, and I'm like, it's very frequent. Yeah,
it's every year. And then you also have to do public performances all the time. Right. And it sounds so tired.
Sounds very, Ooh.
So on May 1993, Beyond returned to Hong Kong with a new album, Rock and Roll. And Boundless Oceans, Vast Skies won Best Original Song that year. And you can listen to the music and it sounds very 90s and you understand why it's so popular, even if you don't understand the lyrics.
Yeah.
But before returning to Japan, the band held a couple of unplugged live concerts in Hong Kong and Malaysia to give back to the fans.
Nice.
And unfortunately, everything's going to go to shit, which is how I always say it.
Oh, man. Here we go.
On June 24th, 1993, which is like a big like ding. If I say a date, it's probably bad.
Okay.
Beyond participated in the filming of a popular Japanese game show, which I'm going to say wrong. Ukcha Nancha no Yanara Yaraneba.
Much better than I could ever say it. And I'm from Japan. So
in the Fuji Television Studio.
Okay.
So 15 minutes after the show started, an accident occurred. The stage floor was very narrow and slippery from water.
No.
And while filming a slapstick fight scene, which is so stupid, which they had just recorded a song about, Wong slipped and fell off the platform with one of the hosts, Teruyoshi Uchimura, while the show was on air.
Okay.
And while Teruyoshi was okay, Wong fell 2.7 meters or 8.85 feet headfirst into the ground.
Oh, no.
Wong fell into a coma immediately was rushed to the hospital. But the traumatic head injury meant that the hospital had to be very cautious when operating on him.
Yeah.
On June 26, 2 days later, several Beyond fans gathered at the car park lot of the commercial radio Hong Kong station to pray for him. Aww. And their management company actually hired a Qigong master to fix the injury, like to heal it. Because, you know, they believe in that stuff. Yeah. You know, and I get it. You you try everything. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Like Christians call on priests to pray for them, the hopes.
Exactly.
So on June 30th, 1993, at 4:15 in the afternoon, a Japanese representative announced that Wong had died of cerebral hemorrhaging in a press conference.
No.
He was 31 years old.
Wow.
Which is very sad because he's younger than me when he died.
Oh my goodness. Yeah.
So Wong's funeral procession caused traffic in various major streets in Hong Kong, and almost every famous Hong Kong canto pop singer was in attendance.
Oh, I'm good.
So on his funeral day, the South China Morning Post wrote, "Screaming fans broke through police burials yesterday as the hearse carrying Won Ka Kui left the Hong Kong funeral home in Quarry Bay. More than 3,000 distraught fans packed the pavements, tram stops, and footbridges outside the funeral parlor in King's Road, yelling Kai Kui and singing the band song." Because they're so distressed and sad about everything that's happening.
A crazy, like, accident.
Yeah. Wow. So although Kai Kui isn't here, we hope he can hear our voice and see how much we miss him, said a 14-year-old girl. So he was buried in the Sing Khan Chinese permanent cemetery, and his tombstone is made out of white marble and bears the image of a guitar.
Wow. Aww.
And he still remains one of Hong Kong's most prominent musicians. Like, they had a series of like pop stars to put on stamps, and he was one of the five people that were on a stamp.
Nice. Good for him.
He was named one of the most missed celebrities, and an asteroid was named after him in 2018. So he's still like, he's like, it's kind of like Elvis. You still miss, or Kurt Cobain. You still miss him,
they honor his memory still. Yeah.
So while the band tried to stay together, Wong's younger brother, Kai Kung, said during a radio interview that a reunion would be impossible and it would be meaningless to continue without his other brother.
True. Yeah, that's true.
So good for him. My story. Wow. And that was really short.
That I was not expecting that crazy turn of events. Holy.
No.
Oh,
I chose a story that wouldn't give you nightmares.
Didn't give me nightmares at all. It was very, very interesting.
And hopefully you enjoyed it.
Yes, from my homeland. Appreciate a good homeland story.
And thank you for listening to my story. And yeah, it's very different without Stephanie like interjecting and asking like a thousand questions, because it makes it really short. So I'm sorry. Is this short?
Yeah. I guess I was supposed to ask more questions. I'm kicked off forever now. Never allowed to come back to the show.
Oh, I know, for sure. I have so many friends.
Yeah, all the guests lining up.
Outdoor of people coming in.
Yep.
Well, I'm sorry that this was too short of a story for us to return, but too bad. This is what you guys get. So thank you for listening, and thank you for being my guest today.
Yes,
Amy.
Thank you for having me.
It feels
I had
way
fun.
Less awkward to talk to
talk to yourself. Yeah,
not than to talk to a wall or a cat who's not going to respond to me at all.
Yeah, and he stopped attacking me now, so that's good.
Yes. So, if you like what we're doing, if you would like to send me an email, my email is peoplekeepdying@gmail.com. You can follow us on. Or you can follow us. You can follow me on all the different social medias.
Follow
her. I respond to them. I came back from the dead. And so hopefully you will be supportive.
And hopefully she doesn't haunt your dreams and nightmares because you didn't follow.
And hopefully I don't die. But Stephanie did promise that if I die prematurely, she will
take over.
At least take one episode to talk about how I died.
Okay. I heard that as well. So yes. I will hold her accountable.
She will be held accountable if I die prematurely to do one podcast episode of me.
Sounds good.
Thank you. And see you next week. Bye.
Bye.
Bye.